If you put a resume into an employer and you have a name that sounds like you're from Southeast Asia or from Africa, people will actually pass you over.
Now, that's true, but you know what else?
Hang on, let me finish. That's not our fault. That's a systemic problem in society that we didn't choose. So when we talk about white privilege, that's what we're talking about. And I'm shocked that we get attacked when we raise these points and say that they're a problem.
Well, there's more than just a race aspect to that. There's a cultural aspect, because I would invite you to send in a resume with the name Bo Cephas on it and see whether or not they, you know, if you've got what sounds like a Smoky Mountains, Tennessee hillbilly name, you'll get passed over as well.
I was born in Red Deer, Alberta. I'm a Canadian. This country is the only country that I've ever known. And yet, all the time, I get people asking me, well, where are you from, Desmond? Where are you from? Well, no, where are you really from? So again, I'm not saying that people are doing that because they're racist or because they don't like me. But privilege means not ever having to have people look at you and have the first thing that they think is, this guy's an outsider. That's a privilege. And I'm not saying that I want
to... Well, what about the people who keep telling me to go back to the United States, when in fact I was born in Gilbert, you know, in Manitoba?
I can't look at you and know that you're from the United States. That's the thing, is that there's an assumption when people look like myself, when people have darker skin, that they must be from another place. And we know that there are people from loyalist black families who have been in this country for centuries. We know that there is a really negative stereotype out there about black people and crime. And what we want is to try and combat that by saying we shouldn't be judged as a race of people by the actions of a few.
Well, I agree with that. I can't assume that you're a criminal or a murderer, that I'm in some sort of danger at the moment, even if we disagree, because you're black and I'm white. On the other hand, if you take just Toronto for an example, where we are, the percentage of murder victims and murderers it vastly outstrips the black population. There is an issue there. It's a gang thing. You have to be able to separate them. But just because that's happening doesn't mean somehow white people are privileged.
Well, let's talk about that. So first of all, we can also say something about the black community in that they live in poverty far more often than people who look like you do. They have worse socioeconomic outputs for their education, for their income, for their health, for all kinds of things.
But black or white, poverty's no excuse for shooting your neighbor.
No, but let's stick to the topic here. Now, I want to ask you, tell me honestly, do you actually think that 85%, 95% of city council is white because all of those people are more, they earned it more than other people? Do you think that all of the CEOs and executives and all of these positions that I talked about, that they're all made majority white because white people just earned it? Or is there something else that's happening?
I wish 85% of them weren't there, frankly, but that's a different discussion altogether. But again, there's enough population in this city for people of minority to change that circumstance
themselves. Yeah, they're trying.
And instead of just blaming it on white people.
No, we're not. There's one section that I want to talk about first here, and it was when one of your guests, JJ, he was talking about how, okay, there might be white privilege, but there's another kind of privilege that people who are not white have. And I was a little surprised, but let's maybe watch it first.
All right.
Two sides to every coin. You know, if you can, there, being a victim, I mean, contradictory as this seems, can often be a form of privilege unto itself in the sense that it generates a great deal of sympathy. You know, if a woman says that she's being denied a promotion because of sexism, if a person of color says that he's being, you know, treated unfairly by the police because of racism, there is a great deal of sympathy that is automatically and uncritically given to these people that make assertions of victimhood. If someone like Tarek goes to the airport and says that, oh, I was singled out for my race and for my religion, he is much more likely to get a lot of sympathy from sort of broad society than if I go to the airport and say I was singled out, and if I say, oh, I was racially profiled, people would tell me to take a hike. So that's a form of privilege as well.
All right, well, go ahead and respond.
Respond to what? He never addressed white privileged. You ask a discussion on white privilege, and you get an argument that because I am discriminated at airports, that is my privilege.
He said, hypothetically, if someone has been, they say that they're the victim of racism, they say that they're the victim of sexism. He seemed to say that when people are suggesting these things, that they're not true. Now, as a white man, JJ...
Well, I don't think he said that.
He was certainly suggesting it, though.
No, that's what you heard him say.
But, well, as a white man, he has not experienced sexism, and he has not experienced racism.
How do you know?
Well, because those things don't affect him the way that they affect women and people of color.
You don't know him. You don't know what his... See, don't make an assumption about his life because you saw him for 20 seconds on television.
Racism doesn't affect people who look like JJ the way that it affects people like me.
I understand you like to think that.
It is not a privilege to be discriminated against and then have to talk about it afterwards. It's actually extremely painful. And once again, if JJ had experienced this, I feel like he would know that. But he seemed not to understand.
All right. While I will agree with you that we agreed in the previous segment that even if there's a high crime rate among blacks in a city, for instance, we can't just assume that every black person is a criminal. That's bigotry. It's racism.
Yeah.
But you've just made a declarative statement about white males.
Which is?
All white males. All white males. Because
that they don't experience something in the same way as me? That's a true statement.
No, but you don't know whether JJ has experienced any kind of discrimination against him because he's a white male or any other aspect of his life.
But you see,
you
Jerry,
don't know who he is.
This is what happens, is that we say we want to talk about white privilege, but instead the conversation becomes what has happened to JJ in his life and what has happened to
I'm just asking you why you can feel comfortable making a declarative statement simply because he's a white guy.